juntar a nós, como já estamos um pouco atrasados, vamos ver se estamos atrasando os 20 mais. Portanto, vamos iniciar esta sessão da tarde com três intervenções. Este é o painel que mais internacional deste bloco. Conta com a presença de dois americanos e de Carlos Halvey, também tem costelas britânicas, não é que esta é uma mesa verdadeiramente corrida do ponto de vista jurídico. Maneira que a primeira intervenção está a cargo do professor Jorge Smith. O professor Jorge Smith vai falar-nos sobre o João Armstrong, o comandante no navio de um combate. Jack Armstrong, Raptor Machine, é da base. O professor Jorge Smith tem um currículo que eu tentei deduzir de uma forma razoável, mas muito longo, ele obteve uma primeira graduação da Universidade de Sandra, na Escócia, e outra na Academia Naval do Maine e na Universidade do Maine. Obteve o prémio John Leiden com uma obra. Esta obra diz muito respeito aqui ao Feial. Borderlands, Smuggling, Patriots, Loyalists and Illicit Trade in the Northeast, 1783-1820. Portanto, isto será qualquer coisa como contrabando de fronteira, patriotas, reais e negócios ilícitos. A Horta teve muita vez estas coisas de. Esta é uma obra que certamente seria muito interessante para nós conhecermos, com a questão da afinidade histórica. Foi editor também do livro Voyages, Documents in American Maritime History, 1492, até ao presente. Em dois volumes, tem mais trabalhos, nomeadamente sobre a guerra de 1812, e é desta área que é considerado um especialista. Recentemente, é professor na Academia da Marinha Mercante dos Estados Unidos e, interinamente, é diretor do Museu Americano da Marinha Mercante em New York. Então, vamos ouvir a comunicação do professor Jorge Smith, como já disse. John Armstrong, the captain, the ship, and the pilot. I suppose you have a PowerPoint, sir.
I do.
We can remain here for a bit. I think we see
yes.
Yes.
Yes. And thank you, Professor, for the lovely introduction. And thank all of you. I can't tell you how humbled and delighted I was when I was invited to come to the Azores, a place I have been reading about for decades. I'm so happy to be here. Really terrific, and I thank everybody for the answers. Reflection notes. So, when I received this invitation, I realized my audience have probably some grasp of English, but I have no Portuguese. So, the problem becomes, how do I present a meaningful show to my audience? And the answer I came up with is, we should use pictures and images to get the message across with very few words. And that approach proved to be very fruitful, because I think the importance of this battle, in fact, is not the battle itself. It's a fierce battle, but a hard-fought battle. But didn't impact things much. But what it does for Americans is it provides a set of stories and pictures and poems and songs that will inspire them in the years after. So I'm not going to talk all that much about the battle itself, because we've heard a lot about that. But I will talk about the captain, captain, and the ship itself. And most of the images of the battle as well. I hope you can all see. The captain, as we know, is Samuel Chester Reed. He's born in Connecticut, but like many Connecticut boys, he moves to New York City. He serves in the U.S. Navy briefly as an acting midshipman in the 1790s. And then the Navy lets him go, the Navy is shrinking, and he becomes a sea captain running commercial vessels, cargo vessels, and he does this for many years, and then will become what is called a privateer. Probably you would call it something like a corsair. And here he is in a lovely painting, painted in 1815, one year after the battle. A young man, only 31, good-looking guy. This is now in Minneapolis, way in the middle of the United States, but the perfect portrait of a naval hero, and I'll show you why. Triangles. Look at the triangles and what they are doing. Yes, I hope you can see it. All these triangles point directly, at his face, right? So this is a perfect image, but it gets better. That hat is a halo. Again, so you have the hero. That's another button here. Let's see if that laser works. This is, in his hand here, is a speaking trumpet. And we know during the battle here in Horta, he would shout to his crew, or at the British, stay away, right, with his speaking trumpet. Held in his left hand, very important. Captain Reed is left-handed. That would be important, but don't forget that. And here is the sword he uses. An interesting sword, not a sailor's sword. This is a French pattern cavalry sword, a horseman's sword, a very fierce weapon, not a genteel weapon, not a gentleman's sword. This is a butcher's sword, right? Serious weapon. Okay? This is left hand. The brass buttons, very sailor-like. To have brass buttons like that, a wonderful coat he's wearing, but we know from his own accounts in the battle, Captain Reed was not wearing a jacket. He was simply wearing a white shirt. That will be important later, too, but we'll look at some of it later. Wonderful eagle on his belt buckle. Eagle, very American. And then finally, we have the flag, right? The American flag, which will also be an important story for this captain. And, of course, again, for the hero, right? Fighting under his flag. Very interesting. Very interesting also because the artist got it wrong. The American flag, the top stripe and the bottom stripe are never white. It's always red. And the artist goofed. The sword. The American Navy has the sword at the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis. They were kind enough to loan me this picture. But again, you can see it's a curved cavalry sword, very heavy weapon, serious killing instrument. After the battle, Captain Reed returns to America, and he is famous. Everybody wants to give him dinners, buy him drinks, and they give him presents. And one of the presents they give him is this sword here. It's called a presentation sword. And this is a gentleman's sword, a very pointy, fine sword, not a butcher's instrument, but for a gentleman. Okay? This is in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. And it has some lovely details. which is this part here. Now, this is an interesting picture. This means something. This is Hercules, or perhaps you call him Heracles here. Okay, strong man, right? Greek mythology. And here he is fighting a lion. And we know from mythology this is called the Nemean lion. And the Nemean lion, you cannot penetrate his hide with a weapon. Hercules breaks a sword on the Nemean lion. He shoots an arrow at him. No good. He must strangle the lion and use his brute strength to kill this lion. Yeah. That's going to be an important story too, because what we have here, the British lion and the American Hercules. He looks very good, doesn't he? And we know this captain, and he's famous now after the battle, but he's a fierce warrior, a good sailor, but he's also a good man. He has good heart. And we know this because of documents like this. This is a pension application from a sailor from the brig General Armstrong, who's wounded in Porto, on board the ship. I think on the Long Tom there was an explosion. And this man was injured. For me as a historian, this is interesting because you can see, perhaps not, his name is John Harrison. He is a black man, or as some people would say, a Negro. Which is interesting to know that there are these people on the ship. This is good history. And this captain, even though my country was a slave-owning republic, this captain has no problem supporting the application for this man, and we have Reed's signature at the bottom saying, yes, this man was wounded. He is very deserving of a pension from the government. So this captain has a good. Because he is a superstar in America, when he is in Washington, D.C. once, he is asked by a congressman to assist in the redesign of the American flag. In 1815, the American flag looks like this. It has 15 stripes. And this is the flag from which the Star Spangled Banner, our national anthem, is named after this flag here. Reed looks at this flag and he says it's a very awkward design, that it should be redone, it should be simplified. Captain Reed's idea is this, is that the American flag should simply have 13 stripes, one for each of the original states, and then you can change the number of stars for the number of states. So Captain Reed designs the modern American flag. That's a big deal. That's a very big deal. So that's quite wonderful. I think this is wonderful. I am a merchant sailor. And I teach merchant sailors. And I like this because here is Reed's sketch of this flag where he has the star design in 13 stripes. He calls this the people's flag, flag of the people, and he connects it directly to people's flag for merchantmen. Merchantmen means commercial ships. So it means the American flag is really, comes from a merchant mariner. It's designed for merchant mariners. Does the Navy have any claims like that? I believe it does not. Okay. There's a little competition between merchant sailors and naval sailors. And of course, the captain eventually dies, as all heroes do. It's a very simple grave. My feathers are different than yours. I thought I was buried in Brooklyn, in New York. And this is, I haven't been to this yet, but I will. Its original grave was very small, and then in the 1950s, they built a much bigger monument for him. I think it's actually Italian-Americans get very involved in this or something. And then, of course, very appropriate to have the American flag he designed on his grave. Now let's talk about the ship, and this ship is very famous, and it represents a very famous type of American corsair or privateer, as we saw. The ship is built in New York City. It is what is called a Baltimore Clipper style, but it is not built in Baltimore. It is built in New York City, but it's a Baltimore Clipper style. They're very fast. Yeah? And we know this from many records. It carries many, many sails, a lot of sail area. It has these wonderful great masts that go back. And it just, when you look at the ship, you know it is built for speed. And it is fast, so it can capture enemy ships. But not a very big ship, and has very little what we call freeboard, what sailors call freeboard. The difference between the water and the rail, very little. So it's a very low ship, which will be a problem in part. So the ship, as we all know, is named after the American Secretary of War, who worked for President Madison. So the owners clearly were political, and they knew this was a good person to name after. He was also a local politician for them. John Armstrong, by the way, will be fired by President Madison. Do we know why? Of course we know why, because Washington, D.C. was burned by the British. And who failed? The Secretary of War did not defend it, so he's fired in disgrace. It's an exceptionally well-equipped ship. It makes numerous cruises from 1812 up until the end of September 1814 against the British. Very successful. And it is equipped with this figurehead. My understanding, so this is not documented yet, my understanding is that this figurehead actually represents Hercules as well. And it is a word play that you have a ship named Armstrong, and Hercules was what? He was strong in the arms, right? So it is a word play, and that restorers have mangled that changed this, that this figure originally was not a person, it was in fact a lion's head, and that represented the Nemean lion. So again, that Hercules theme comes in. And of course, this ship is a corsair, it's not a naval vessel, it is a business proposition. They're there to make money. And so the crew are not paid wages, they are paid like fishermen. Fishermen only make money with what? If they catch fish. And privateersmen, of course, theirs only make money if they capture ships. And this is one of the crew members. He actually gets a little slip of paper, says you get one share out of whatever it is. You don't capture anything. Again, another image of the ship. I don't know where this image is, but I think it's quite realistic of it, showing the rig and the figurehead. Again, you can see the bow is very low. That has an American flag. I think that has 15 stripes, but it's very small. You've got the better eyes than me. Again, you can see the raked mast. So, the battle itself, there are different views, of course. The Americans have one view, which they glorify, and they elevate the number of British who were killed. And they say, it's very important, eventually in the 1830s, they begin to say it impacted the Battle of New Orleans. I have my doubts about this. There's a British view. The British have a very different view. They say, no, not so many died. But we know that the British officer in charge, Robert Lloyd, lied in his official report to the Admiralty in London. And we also know that the Admiralty did not believe his report, and they took Captain Lloyd to task. He got in a lot of trouble for this because we know the attack did not go very well. So, and of course, then there's a Portuguese view, which is truly neutral. You know, because Portugal was neutral in this war, and the Portuguese have nothing to lie about. And the governor here, Ribeiro, makes extensive reports about this battle. And in fact, he's very upset with the British, who sort of invade Portuguese sovereignty, and he calls Captain Lloyd basically mad, a crazy man. This battle was unnecessary, it did not have to happen. It was an unnecessary killing of people, including Portuguese subjects, as they would have been back then, subjects, not citizens, die. Listen, he's not happy about that. So this is the famous picture of the battle, probably the most famous in America. This is a terrible picture. I love to hate this picture. It is so inaccurate, and we'll go through why. First off, look how tall this ship is. It's a very big vessel, and a very beamy vessel, not the sharp, speedy little brigantine, but a big, clumsy ship. There is nobody in the fighting tops shooting down at the British, and we know this happened. And inflicted fearsome casualties. You can imagine being in an open rowboat and somebody shooting down at you. Very scary proposition. The British fleet in the background, I think, really wasn't a player in this battle. It's all the open boats. And of course, where's the moon? This looks like it's daylight. This was a nighttime battle. So this is a horrible, horrible picture. Do not like it. This picture is in the New York Historical Society, and I think this is pretty good. Done by Thomas Birch, very close to the time of the battle, and I think he was getting, he may have even talked to Captain Reed when he did the sketch, but, you know, here's the castle, the battery, and you can see how close it is to shore. So there are a lot of good things here. You can see the vessel's not under sail. I don't see anybody in the fighting tops. Forgive me on that one. That you can see how low the ship is, and the British are just swarming on board. Right? Fierce hand-to-hand combat. You can see the townspeople, right, are watching this battle, which is a bit of a foolish thing to do. Right? There are bullets flying through the air, but people are furious everywhere, right? They want to see the action. And of course, the moon is shining in the sky, so that's very good. This is another painting. I don't know where the original is. It looks like quite a lovely painting, but it too has its issues. I like the lights of the town in the background. You know it's at night. But no, we know that the General Armstrong was only maybe 20 meters off the castle. It's very close to shore. That's what Captain Reed says in Anglo terms. It was 60 feet offshore, or not even 20 meters. So very, very close. You can see the ship is just lit up with combat, right? The flash of the guns. And you can see there are some people up in the masts as the British boats approach. And the British fleet, way far in the distance, lights lit up, not really part of the battle. Pretty good. I wish I knew where the original
is. It might be with the Navy. The hardest to your phone is after the field.
Yes, you did. I know it's not at the Naval Academy, and I don't think it's in Washington, but the Navy doesn't know where it is. But this is my favorite. This is a wonderful monkey painting. We found this at the Franklin D. Roosevelt Library in Hyde Park, New York. Franklin Roosevelt bought this in the 1920s. A few years later, he became the longest serving American president, the president who led my nation during the Second World War, very important man, big on naval history. Okay? And he bought this painting because he liked naval history. It was also bought an extremely famous artist, Emanuel Leutz, German, that immigrates to America. He's better known for doing a famous painting of George Washington crossing the Delaware River during the American Revolution. So a very famous artist who likes to paint American history. And this is a cool painting. You can see, again, the very little freeboard that's going on. You can see the fierce combat. And here's a figure in a white shirt. I wish I had I could blow it up for you. Figure in a white shirt engaged in sword combat with one of the Britons. This is almost assuredly Captain Reed. And Captain Reed does get involved in hand-to-hand combat with a British officer. Now think about this. Captain Reed fights with his left hand. Most officers fight with their right. And they're used to fighting to people who are right-handed. If you are a left-handed swordsman, you have a huge advantage. In fact, Captain Reed will take that heavy French cavalry saber and he will kill that British officer. So that is that weapon you saw, it is a killing weapon. It has killed people. Reed himself is wounded in the combat. He's cut in the head, not badly, and he almost loses a finger. But I don't know which finger, and I don't know which hand. So more research is needed. Marksman of the fighting types. The artist gets this absolutely right. The moonlight, bright, bright moon. The British fleet far in the distance. Yes, I think that, there's not nice action with the British ships pressing in, but I think it shows the urgency of the desperation of this battle, which went on 40 minutes, this hand-to-hand combat, very fierce, lots of British, over 100 dead, and many more wounded. Okay, so to conclude, yes, the British win this battle, right? They see this privateer is destroyed, the Americans destroy it themselves. Not only do the Americans fire cannonballs through its bottom, but they also cut off the masts of this ship, so it will never be any use to the British. But the General Armstrong is so close to the fort, it is in such shallow water, that when it sinks, maybe that far, the British actually cannot tell it is sunk, and they continue to fire cannons at it for 10 to 20 minutes, not realizing it's now resting. And then they send in sailors and they burn it to finish the job. Thank you. So this is a pyrrhic victory for the British. Let us say they take tremendous losses. They get no advantage out of the battle. Celebrated by the Americans. And I think the important thing the Americans get us in this battle is they get images that prove to them that they can fight the British. They're not always going to win, but we know we can imagine ourselves winning in the future. If we do this well as a very young, weak nation, in the future we can do better, and the American flag and these pictures will be used by Americans to prove that we can become a great sea power, which we do in the 1890s, which is pretty much when Long Tom comes back to the United States. So there's a coincidence. That is my presentation. I thank you for your interest.
If he would have forgotten,
Yes. Vamos então ter esta segunda intervenção por tarde, que terá um tipo de honoring the brave artifacts from privateer General Armstrong. Este honoring the brave, it reminds me of the land of the brave. Ora, o professor Gordon Calhoun também tem um currículo que impressiona. É licenciado em História pelo College de Worcester, e tem um Master em História pela Universidade de Old Dominion. Tem ainda um certificado na área de Esforço Político e Estratégia pelo Naval War College. Tem feito pesquisa e publicação sobre História da Marinha no século XIX e, mais recentemente, em História Social sobre o Marinheiro Americano. É historiador ao serviço do Museu Naval de Great Lakes, no estado de Illinois, que é um dos 10 museus da Marinha dos Estados Unidos, e ainda foi, embora mais jovem, ainda foi 19 anos, imagina-se, historiador do Hampton Roads Naval Museum em Norfolk. Portanto, vamos ouvir a intervenção do Sr. Paulo Callum. A vossa atenção, you have 25 minutes of glory.
Thank you. I work for the U.S. Navy. You know, I work on behalf of Dylan Budd, the college director of naval history, and we have in the collection two artifacts from General Armstrong, long time, the 42-pounder cannon. It's currently at the National Museum of the U.S. Navy in Washington, D.C. And you've seen pictures of Noam, old general, the figurehead. My colleagues will talk a little bit about him, talk a little bit more about him. And he is at the, he is at the U.S. Naval Academy Museum in Annapolis, Maryland. But let me take you to 1893. What is 1893? It's the 400th anniversary of Christopher Columbus coming to the New World. And the United States loves World's Fairs at this time period. They love to celebrate their history and try to make money at the same time by throwing really big World's Fairs. This is the one held in Chicago. It's probably the grandest of them all. And they call it the World Columbian Exposition. Most of this in this area here, they're called White City, is all white classical architecture built all over what is called Jackson Park in Chicago. And one of the exhibits was the great German steel mill and gun manufacturer Krupp brought their big gun. They bought their 16-inch rifle, the 406mm rifle, to show off the world. We're Germans. We build big guns. And very popular. This is Scientific American magazine said this was the best exhibit. Scientific American was the popular engineering magazine, still around the present day. They thought this was the best exhibit on the whole fair. But one newspaper writer out of Boston took exception to that and said, then the Krupp guns are nice, but there's this gun that you need to see called Long Tom. So they have a history and honorable long, not as formal of metal as the Krupp affair, but it must be awarded the blue ribbon for services remembered. These guns never did anything. Long Tom did. And Long Tom had to can a lot of competition. You might even know something called the Ferris Wheel. A guy jumped in there, George Ferris, built the very first one of these at the Columbian Exposition. At the Columbian Exposition, there are what's called the World Congress of Religions. Buddhism is introduced for the first time to the United States from this fair. So there's a lot of competition. And out of all that competition, people want to come see Long Tom and Old General. And the Chicago Tribune, big newspaper today, big newspaper back then, immediately takes notice in the U.S. Navy exhibit of the gun, of this 42-pounder gun, and of this figurehead that they call Old General. And talk about the gun itself. What the Chicago Tribune writer came up with this line about what the gun represented. It represents Yankee pluck, bravery, honor, courage. And he uses that line often
This is something very tangible. That's the importance of any artifact in any museum of any time period. It is something real. We people in the museum business get very sort of touchy about when people ask me, why do you have a museum? They say you can just see it online. We can actually, when somebody, whether it's a child or an adult, you can see the real thing. And here people are paying to see the real artifacts from this famous battle that Professor Smith just got them describing, and that people can actually see and touch it. And so it creates this legacy. Now, the weapon itself, this is three different angles of the gun itself. It's actually a French-made gun. The gun itself was made by the French. It was originally a 36-pounder and reborn to a 42-pounder. By 42-pounder, we mean that's the weight of the shot it's actually firing. The gun itself weighs over 7,500 pounds. It is originally made for French ship of lines. The French ship of line, like many French ships in this time period, captured by the British in the 1790s. And the British want the ship, they don't want the gun. So they sell the gun. They sell the gun to American arms dealers. Americans take it back. And who wants it? The Haitians want it. The Haitians are in the process of trying to overthrow the French. And so they put it aboard one of their own privateers. And then it does battle with a French privateer. And actually does quite a good service. But then they decide maybe it's too expensive, got concrete, and actually defeated the French ground forces. So they sell it back to the same American arms dealers in New York City. And then come Long Tom. That's one of the owners of Long Tom. I mean, the owners of the general dealer, Greg Armstrong. These privateers were entrepreneurs. They had owners at home who bought the ship, hired people like Captain Reed to man them, find the crew, find the guns, and they're out to make money. And this is one of the owners of the Armstrong. He sees Long Tom sitting on the docks. Most of them would have been purchased by the U.S. Army, but this one gun looked a little defective. Said, what's that gun? Said, well, that's a 42-pounder. I'll take it. We need it for our ship. We need a big gun for our ship. I said, buy yours. And then the gun itself, every gun, I would like to tell you that this is the only gun called Long Tom, but every privateer that served during the War of 1812 had several little guns and one Long Tom. Every one of them called it a long time. 30 pounds, 42 pounds, 4,200. It was a long time. But here's the legacy of battle. Right there, they're long time in action. Fighting, you know, just the gun that is helping fend off this swarm of British sailors and Marines trying to face the ship. And then the gun is used to scuttle. The scuttle the ship in shallow water. And then the Portuguese, the Azores, raise the gun out of the water and place it in this fort that you're currently in. And this is the British, the Portuguese infantry. I do not know who that gentleman is in the middle, standing by it. But they're very proud of this gun. They're very proud of what the Americans did. And it stays here until 1890, when Colonel Reed, the son of the captain, comes over to the Azores. He wants to do a book about the battle. And someone said, well, you should see your father's gun. And he says, well, why don't we get it back in the United States? I want to put it in Lafayette Park. Lafayette Park is the park right across from the White House in Washington, D.C. Well, the Navy gets a hold of it and hears that his gun might be coming home and says, we have a better idea. We're setting up a big exhibit in Chicago, and there are going to be upwards of 4 million people are going to see this. We want to bring it to Chicago. And Reed said, that's a great idea. Let's take it there. Now, figureheads are the embodiment of any ship. Almost every whaling ship, sailing ship of this time period, the New Bedford Museum, several museums around the world, they have figureheads of these works of art. There's the one on the left there, that is the figureheads themselves usually represent the name of the ship. The one on the left there, that is the chief of the Delaware Indians, comes off the USS Delaware. In the middle there, that is Hercules was very popular, that is impressive, American ships. This comes off the USS Ohio, which was one of the largest shipping lines that we ever built. On the right there, that is President Andrew Jackson. It was on the frigate Constitution, our most famous warship. That is actually the third figurehead that Constitution had. Its first one, Hercules. that got shot off during a battle with the British frigate. So they put the President Jackson one on. To show how valuable people thought of these figureheads,
And President Jackson was one of these people you either really loved them or you really hated them. Well, a group of people in Boston really hated Andrew Jackson, and they can't get to the president himself, so they went over to the next best thing, and went over to the figurehead of the Constitution and cut off his head. And it became a national scandal. Who cut off Jackson's head? The American figureheads are to be largely responsible for this man, William Rush, who was a sculptor here in America. He taught a whole, he had several apprentices who taught other apprentices and created a very distinctive American style figurehead, very detailed, in many cases on merchant ships, they were always in color. You'll notice the Andrew Jackson one, it's whitewashed, it's very white. For warships, he preferred to have it look like it was made out of stone, so he whitewashed them. On merchant ships, he wanted to be painted them, and he wanted to have color. And so even though William Rush had two old generals, one of his students definitely did. None of the students ever, like many American artists, came over to Europe to learn about European styles of artwork. None of the sculptors or figurehead carvers, they made these all out of wood. And William Rush thought so much of himself, he did that one himself. He definitely created his exclusivity of American style of art. On the left there, that was good one for a merchant ship that come from the whaling ship Commodore Morris. And on the right there, that is Benjamin Franklin for the USS Franklin. Which gets us to Old General. That is John Armstrong on the left. And that is John not Armstrong on the right. I'm open to the Hercules interpretation. Is open to interpretation of what this is. This is a very unique figurehead. Roman general is another, has been suggested, because Roman, mentioned Roman, Americans love everything Roman and Greek, classical Roman and Greek at this time. Unlike other figureheads, this figurehead does not represent the man he's supposed to, represent. You've probably heard about Alfonso Vendicano, that one little postcard to the U.S. consulate in Britain in 1903. The figurehead has returned, third generation Dabney. He is invited to join what's called be on the board of what's called a Naval Lyceum. This is the beginnings of the U.S. Navy Museum system. These were at the Navy Yards, they collected all these artifacts from wars past. And Dabney's asked to be on the board of the Boston Naval Lyceum. And he writes back and says, I accept, and by the way, I'm bringing the figurehead home. It has been beaten down by the weather. You've seen this picture a few times and notice it's missing an eye. It's very discolored. There was battle damage. And said, I'm bringing the figurehead home with me. So he brings it home to Boston. Now, eventually, all the Lyceums close, and all those artifacts go to the U.S. Naval Academy. Where they build their own museum, and that's why the figurehead is there today. Now, the exposition itself, the Navy at this time period wants, in the 1890s, wants to publicize the Navy. They have to sell the idea of a brand new Navy to the American taxpayers. So the new Navy is very expensive, and they want to tell the story that the American Navy has done very well in the last few years. They also want to show the future. They couldn't bring a battleship onto Lake Michigan into Chicago as much as they would like to try. So they built one out of wood. They called it the USS, in quotes, Illinois. It really wasn't. And inside the Illinois, this is an exact replica of one of the battleships of the time period. And inside the Illinois were all these exhibits. Every piece of art of equipment the Navy could pull out, 4,000 items were brought. Also electronical gear and navigation equipment, and as part of their historic exhibit, there's a future, past, and present theme to this. And the past is they bring in some artifacts that belong to Reed, and they bring in Long Tom, and they bring in Old General. Why is it the great legacy? Testament says a little bit about the legacy. There's a story about how it saved New Orleans. There's also an American military history. If we lose a battle, but we fight well, it's still a victory. on the top there, one of the most famous expressions in American English is don't give up the ship. This occurs from the Battle of the Frigate Chesapeake, which happened off the coast of Boston against the HMS Shannon. As the captain of the Chesapeake, James Lawrence, and a very romanticized, being taken down below, look at his hand there, he says, The quote is, don't give up the ship, men. Keep firing faster, faster, faster. Of course, the ironic part is he lost the ship, and this is the greatest defeat the U.S. Navy has ever had since before Pearl Harbor. The Chesapeake was captured, hauled back to Nova Scotia, Canada. Great celebration. Down below, that's the Alamo. That's another one of our favorite expressions. Remember the Alamo. That's Davy Crockett, fighting off the last man to fight off the Mexicans. Both of these expressions of love. We love to talk about stories, even though we lost the battle. We love to turn it into not just a victory, but a fighting spirit, a Yankee pluck, as the tribute writer likes to call it. Here's the exposition itself. There's the USS Illinois. Now, this was Norway's, but in front of it, this is Norway's contribution. This was an international exposition. Several countries brought stuff to this. And the Norwegians had just discovered a real longship intact in Norway. So they decided, let's build a replica longship. This is still around, too. Somewhere in Illinois or Wisconsin, we're not sure. But it's still around. And there's USS Illinois in the background. And this publication, this thing, the wonderful battle of the brave General Armstrong, this publication is printed at the exact same time as the exhibition. It's printed in 1893. The fair's over. The 4 million people saw it. It is in terms of publicity, it's the most success the Navy ever asked for. After the fair, the old general goes back to the Naval Academy, and Long Tom goes to Washington Navy Yard, which is the home of the Navy gun factory. This is where the Navy forges its battleship guns. And outside the Navy gun factory, which is today the Navy Museum, they have all these historic guns captured from Confederates during the American Civil War, ones that were used by the U.S. Navy during the World War XII and several other wars. And so they just start building a gun park right outside. And Long Tom joins this very distinguished group of guns used over the last 100 years. And then it gets moved into Building 76 of the Washington Navy Yard, where eventually the Navy does start up I work for a group called the Navy History and Heritage Command. This is the Navy's official history agency. I work for one of them. And they have most of their operations are at the Washington Navy Yard, compiling the official histories, trying to keep track of all the thousands of artifacts that we have. And then we have the 10 Navy museums, everything from naval aviation down in Florida to where I work right now. It's called the Great Lakes Naval Museum. Brochures are in the back. And that is where, just north of about 35 miles north of Chicago, this is where the Navy has their only boot camp, where they train sailors before they send them off to Norfolk, Virginia, where it's home of the Atlantic Fleet, or San Diego, which is the home of the Pacific Fleet. And this is where I got the title from. They were told now they're wine. Professors would talk out of their wine and dine everywhere. Well, this is when they came to Richmond. They announced Richmond came to Richmond, Virginia. They were coming up from Savannah, Georgia. And Richmond announced, "They're coming! They're coming! Let's all buy the beer! Come to know!" And it was honor to the parade. And the parade was headlined. That's a big type for the time period. This is basically a war award been declared. That's where I got my title for my exhibit, my presentation when I saw that. That's all I have. Thank you.
That's for a compensation of that name. Vocês fazem história na Universidade Clássica de Lisboa, o trouxe em história contemporânea e na Universidade dos Açores, tem vastíssima obra de publicar tédios em revistas, livros, atas de muitos colóquios e muitos congressos em que tem participado, e presentemente concentra os seus interesses de, a nível da investigação histórica, na área da história da aviação, das relações entre Portugal e os Estados Unidos, relações internacionais em geral, história dos Açores é sempre um componente presente nas suas publicações, e história dos Estados Unidos e as relações internacionais é uma componente que ele mais recentemente vem privilegiando, e também, isto dará resposta às novas vertentes que a Universidade dos Açores procura encetar novas perspectivas ao nível da docência, também se tem dedicado muito ao turismo cultural que já tem nesse lugar na Universidade dos Açores. Tem a palavra o Sr. Professor de Artes da Universidade.
Obrigado. Eu peço para não acreditar em metade do que o Ricardo diz. Só a amizade e o exagero de biologia levou, enfim, a todos estes adjetivos. Queria também pedir desculpa, porque depois destas excelentes apresentações com PowerPoint, eu suponho que, enfim, a minha apresentação vai-vos saber a carnes frias. Não tenho PowerPoint, vou ler uma comunicação, enfim, espero que o assunto não seja árido demais. E peço ao Sr. Presidente da mesa a sua indulgência, alguns descontos, porventura, ou pelo menos que me sinalize 5 minutos antes que eu puder. Pronto, vou já aproveitar os créditos e começar já a falar para não perder mais tempo. Ora, a Batalha de Faial, que teve lugar no Porto da Horta, foi uma das muitas refregas que ocorreram no palco atlântico da Guerra Naval de 1812. Mas destacou-se todas as outras pelo facto de estar relacionada com o sucesso militar do general Andrew Jackson na Batalha de New Orleans, que foi a vitória mais expressiva das forças americanas sobre as britânicas no decurso desse conflito, que, segundo alguns, assinala o ponto final de um longo parágrafo das guerras da independência. Um dos autores que sublinhou justamente esta ligação entre o combate travado pelo General Armstrong e o desfecho da Batalha de New Orleans foi Theodore Roosevelt, na sua obra The Naval War of 1812. Roosevelt fazia então, estávamos na altura em 1882, Roosevelt fazia então a sua estreia literária, foi o primeiro livro que ele publicou. Tinha acabado de sair de Harvard, tinha 23 anos de idade, mas o livro, esta obra, foi de imediato adotado pelo Naval War College e ainda hoje é apontado como um estudo de referência no âmbito da historiografia sobre a Guerra Naval de 1812. Se eu destaque esta obra, entre muitíssimas outras possíveis, não é apenas pelo facto de Theodore Roosevelt ter desempenhado o cargo de Presidente dos Estados Unidos da América, mas também porque se deu a circunstância, porventura menos conhecida, de Roosevelt ter visitado o Porto e a cidade da Horta a 29 de março de 1909, pouco tempo depois, aliás, de ter abandonado as funções presidenciais. Efetivamente, conforme noticiava o jornal O Telégrafo na sua edição do dia 30 de março, e cito, o ex-presidente da América do Norte manifestou o desejo de desembarcar no Faial por ser, disse ele, a ilha dos Açores que mais se prende à história dos Estados Unidos, em alguns dos seus lances mais dramáticos. Ora, os lances mais dramáticos do século XIX americano, aqueles em que a sobrevivência da União esteve, de facto, em causa, foram, precisamente, a Guerra de 1812 e depois a Guerra Civil de 1861-65, nas quais os Açores e a Ilha de Faial, como toda a gente sabe, sede do consulado americano no arquipélago, desempenharam um papel relevante, muito embora estivessem situados na periferia marítima dos conflitos em apreço. Theodore Roosevelt, um conhecido apóstolo das doutrinas do poder naval, estava bem ciente desse facto e, de certo, aproveitou a escala no Porto da Horta para recordar a façanha do General Armstrong e do seu intrépido comandante Samuel Chester Reed, uma figura, como já foi aqui amplamente sublinhado pelos oradores precedentes, uma figura com um lugar cativo no panteão americano e nas enciclopédias e dicionários navais de toda a sorte. O redator do Telégrafo certamente desconhecia o estudo de Roosevelt sobre a Guerra Naval de 1812. Caso contrário, não teria enjeitado a oportunidade de fazer referência ao episódio do General Armstrong numa notícia publicada acerca do ilustre visitante. O próprio ex-presidente, aliás, nas cartas escritas a familiares e amigos durante a sua travessia transatlântica, não faz qualquer alusão à Batalha de Faial quando relata as suas impressões de viagem sobre a escala nos Açores. Escala essa que, aliás, passou despercebida à maioria do público e foi em grande parte ignorada pelas autoridades locais. Não é agora o momento para desenvolver este assunto, mas a tal de foi-se vale a pena sublinhar o silêncio que envolveu a passagem deste estadista pelas ilhas do Faial e São Miguel, sobretudo tendo em consideração que Theodore Roosevelt foi, a par de James Monroe, o presidente que mais decisivamente marcou a política externa americana no século XIX. Deixando de lado Roosevelt, centremos agora a atenção sobre James Monroe. Esse sim, diretamente ligado à questão do General Armstrong, pois, à data do acontecimento, era ele o Secretary of State a quem John Bass Dernie endereçou o primeiro relatório sobre o ataque ao brigue americano, qualificando o sucedido na Horta, e cito, como uma muito ultrajante violação da neutralidade deste porto. Como não estou a falar para leigos, aliás, as comunicações que me precederam dispensam-me de proceder à reconstituição do combate naval, propriamente dito, e avanço de imediato para as suas implicações diplomáticas, que se encontram, aliás, delineadas no parágrafo final da carta do cônsul Dernie, que passo a citar. O capitão Reed protestou contra os comandantes britânicos da esquadra pela injustificável destruição do seu navio num porto neutral e amistoso, bem como contra o governo de Portugal pela sua incapacidade de protegê-lo. Não há dúvida que este governo, o português, entenda-se, se sentirá obrigado a conceder ampla compensação aos proprietários oficiais e tripulação deste navio pela grande perda que severamente sofreram. Transmitirei tão cedo quanto possível um relatório deste assunto ao nosso ministro no Rio de Janeiro. Fim de citação. Ora, encontrando-se os Estados Unidos em guerra com a Grã-Bretanha, nota de protesto apresentado aos comandantes da flotilha britânica, cumpriu, por assim dizer, uma mera figura de protocolo. Mas o mesmo não se pode dizer da reclamação dirigida ao governo português pela incapacidade demonstrada em fazer respeitar as leis da neutralidade nas suas águas. Como se conclui das palavras do cônsul americano, esperava-se que Portugal assumisse a responsabilidade do pagamento das indemnizações devidas aos proprietários do General Armstrong, que, em conformidade com a carta dirigida em dezembro de 1814 pelos armadores do brigue ao secretário de Estado, estava calculada a indemnização em cerca de $30.700. James Monroe, salvo o devido respeito pelo assunto que aqui celebramos, tinha mais que fazer. Mas, para melhor podermos avaliar as exigências do seu cargo, Monroe, nessa altura, importa olhar, como soube dizer-se, para o big picture. Por curiosa coincidência, na própria data que hoje nos encontramos a celebrar, 27 de setembro de 1814, Monroe tinha sido nomeado pelo presidente James Madison para o cargo de secretário de guerra. Funções que passaria a acumular com as de secretário de Estado. Esta nomeação surgira na sequência da pior humilhação sofrida pelos americanos na guerra de 1812. E essa humilhação ocorreu no dia 24 de agosto de 1814 e foi o raid, o ataque das forças britânicas sobre a capital do governo federal, Washington D.C., e o incêndio de diversos edifícios emblemáticos, entre os quais a Casa Branca e o Capitólio. Ora, ao longo do período em que James Monroe desempenhou estes dois cargos, entre outubro de 1814 e março de 1815, sucederam-se em catadupa acontecimentos da maior importância. O primeiro, a Convenção de Hartford, no Connecticut, na qual os federalistas da Nova Inglaterra, que se opunham terminantemente à guerra contra a Grã-Bretanha, ameaçavam e queriam a secessão da União. Em segundo lugar, a assinatura do Tratado de Ghent, na Bélgica, que veio pôr termo à guerra de 1812. E, por último, o já referido sucesso de Andrew Jackson na Batalha de New Orleans, que ajudou a projetar uma imagem vitoriosa dos Estados Unidos no final de um longo conflito que, para muitos, não teve vencedores. Pois o Tratado de Ghent restaurava o chamado status quo ante bellum das fronteiras anglo-americanas que tinha sido consagrado no Tratado de Paris de 1783. Contrariando a ideia expressa no aforismo francês plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose, o desfecho da guerra de 1812 representou para a jovem República Americana uma viragem decisiva no curso do seu destino coletivo, e James Monroe foi, em grande parte, o principal artífice dessa mudança. Um dos bons exemplos das muitas diferenças ocorridas no território americano entre 1783 e 1815 é a chamada Louisiana Purchase, porventura a maior operação imobiliária jamais realizada no mundo ocidental, e à qual James Monroe esteve ligado como conselheiro pessoal de Thomas Jefferson. Ora, a célebre Batalha de New Orleans, que aqui muito tem sido falado, e à qual o General Armstrong e a Ilha de Faial estão inalienavelmente ligados, ajudou a cimentar a Louisiana Purchase em termos geopolíticos, com, em primeiro lugar, segurando um porto estratégico no Golfo de México, que é New Orleans, em segundo lugar, avançando a fronteira americana até o rio Mississippi e consolidando o desenvolvimento da economia, ajudando a consolidar o desenvolvimento da economia esclavagista do algodão na região do chamado Deep South. Esta deriva para o sul da dinâmica expansionista da União, conjugada com o fim das hostilidades com a Grã-Bretanha, veio afastar a ameaça de secessão por parte dos Estados da Nova Inglaterra, inaugurando um sentimento de unidade interna e de otimismo que, embora transitório, marcam o início de funções de James Monroe, que, entretanto, é eleito presidente dos Estados Unidos da América a 4 de março de 1817. Ora, todo este turbilhão de acontecimentos submergiu, num primeiro momento, as sequelas diplomáticas do episódio do General Armstrong. Mas o assunto voltaria à tona quando o envolvimento de corsários americanos nas guerras da independência, desencadeadas por Simón Bolívar e por José Artigas, trouxe para o primeiro plano da agenda política em Washington a discussão das leis da neutralidade. O termo da guerra de 1812, no decurso do qual a frota mercante americana tinha sido mobilizada para atividades de curso, lançou, por assim dizer, no desemprego, um considerável número de embarcações, que, a partir de 1816, munidas das chamadas cartas de marca emitidas por José Artigas, vão lavrar as águas do Atlântico sob o pavilhão das Províncias Unidas do Rio de Bela Plata, atacando, indistintamente, embarcações portuguesas e espanholas que nelas encontravam. Como seria de esperar, Portugal não tardou a apresentar ao governo americano o seu protesto por estes ataques e fê-lo através do seu representante em Washington, José Correia da Serra, uma figura cujo prestígio ímpar no âmbito das relações luso-americanas me obriga a abrir aqui um parênteses para melhor podermos compreender a forma peculiar como ele interagiu com a administração Monroe nesta delicada conjuntura diplomática. O abade, ele era abade, o abade José Correia da Serra chegou aos Estados Unidos em inícios de 1812. Espírito erudito e enciclopédico, membro respeitado da República das Ciências Europeia, que emergira no iluminismo tardio, desembarcou em Norfolk já como sócio correspondente à American Philosophical Society, e as cartas de recomendação de que vinha munido, muitas delas dirigidas ao ex-presidente Thomas Jefferson, proporcionaram-lhe uma rápida integração no seio da elite política e intelectual norte-americana. Não me irei agora deter sobre a sua fascinante biografia, designadamente a parte respeitante à estadia em terras americanas, mas recomendo aos interessados a leitura dos trabalhos de Richard Beale Davis e de Léon Bourdon, que já estão publicados sobre este tema. Quando apresenta a James Monroe as suas credenciais de embaixador, em julho de 1816, Correia da Serra é o representante diplomático do Reino Unido, de Portugal, Brasil e Algarves. A única monarquia europeia cujo centro político se tinha deslocado para a periferia do Novo Mundo, assentando arraiais na Baía do Rio de Janeiro, e que, nesse sentido, apresentava fortes afinidades, se não políticas, pelo menos geográficas, com a jovem República Americana. Este sentimento de paridade geopolítica entre as duas nações encontra-se, aliás, cabalmente traduzido na carta em que Correia da Serra comunica ao presidente James Madison a sua nomeação como representante diplomático português. E passo a citar: quanto ao futuro, tenho boas expectativas, pelo menos durante a minha missão, que um ministro português seja, para os Estados Unidos, uma espécie de ministro da família. De facto, neste momento, as nossas nações são ambas potências americanas. E serão sempre as duas soberanas, cada uma na sua parte do novo continente. Tenho também a consciência de que nenhum ministro estrangeiro alguma vez veio para os Estados Unidos com um tal apego sincero a esta nação como eu. Nem é provável que algum venha nos próximos tempos. Fim de citação. É precisamente nesta qualidade de ministro da família que Correia da Serra irá procurar dirimir os problemas levantados pelos corsários americanos de Baltimore, entre os quais, curiosamente, se encontrava um açoriano chamado José de Almeida. Mas isso seria assunto para outra comunicação. Ora, a forma como Correia da Serra vai procurar dirimir estes problemas é bastante original. Porquê? Porque ele vai trabalhar em conjunto com o Departamento de Estado na redação de um texto que, depois de aprovado pelo Congresso a 3 de março de 1817, passaria a ser conhecido como a Lei da Neutralidade. Este documento legislativo, reconhecidamente uma pedra angular da política externa norte-americana, teve, portanto, a assinatura indelével de Correia da Serra, que a ele se referia como a sua lei. James Monroe, que é uma testemunha suspeita, reconheceu mais tarde, em carta dirigida ao seu secretário de Estado, John Quincy Adams, o crédito do ministro português na elaboração desta lei que, apesar da perenidade dos seus princípios, depressa viria a ser ultrapassada pelos acontecimentos. E, efetivamente, ao mesmo tempo que a lei da neutralidade era aprovada, arrebentava no Recife aquela que ficou conhecida pelo nome de Revolução Pernambucana. A chegada de emissários deste movimento revolucionário a Washington, em maio de 1817, na tentativa de captar o apoio norte-americano à sua causa, levou Correia da Serra a reagir de forma destemperada junto do presidente James Monroe, que de imediato o afastou de qualquer convívio íntimo e pessoal, recomendando ao seu secretário do Departamento de Estado, Quincy Adams, que fechasse as portas a este estilo de diplomacia familiar que o ministro português tanto gostava de cultivar. Estava dado o sinal para uma mudança de paradigma nas relações entre os dois países. E não obstante a Revolução Pernambucana tivesse sido empafada, os problemas causados pelos corsários americanos ao serviço de Artigas continuavam a minar o clima de tensão diplomática, erodindo os sentimentos de afeto que Correia da Serra tinha até então demonstrado pela nação americana. Quer em missivas dirigidas ao Departamento de Estado, quer nas páginas dos jornais, o diplomata português não se coibia de chamar a Baltimore a cidade argelina da América do Norte e, em 1819, publica, sob a capa do anonimato, um extenso panfleto, publica em Nova Iorque, um extenso panfleto intitulado An Appeal to the Government and Congress of the United States Against the depredations committed by American privateers on the commerce of nations at peace with us. Já é tempo de terminar,
acho eu,
mas não sem antes esclarecer, ainda vou demorar algum pouco, mas não sem antes esclarecer de que forma justamente o episódio do General Armstrong se articula com os problemas levantados a Portugal por esta frota de barbaria, por utilizar a expressão, do Correio da Serra. Em março de 1817, um navio desta frota de corsários, sugestivamente matriculado em Baltimore com o nome de Buenos Aires Patriot, vai saquear nos mares dos Açores três embarcações portuguesas que se dirigiam do Brasil para Lisboa. Chamavam-se elas Senhor do Alívio, Marquês de Pombal e São João Protetor. Ora, este saque sobre estas três embarcações portuguesas vai motivar uma carta de protesto de Correia da Serra, John Quincy Adams, na qual este lhe comunica com cordialidade diplomática que, e passo a citar, a perfeita amizade que Sua Majestade o Rei de Portugal mantinha com os Estados Unidos inclinavam-no a esperar que o governo dos Estados Unidos estivesse na disposição de satisfazer e indemnizar o prejuízo causado aos súbditos de Sua Majestade e a afronta feita à bandeira por cidadãos americanos indignos dessa cidadania. A resposta de Quincy Adams não se fez esperar, argumentando que, e cito, o governo dos Estados Unidos, tendo usado todos os meios ao seu alcance para impedir que nos seus portos se equipem e armem navios que vão prejudicar qualquer nação que esteja em paz com os Estados Unidos, não se pode considerar obrigado a indemnizar indivíduos estrangeiros por perdas e danos causados por capturas sobre as quais os Estados Unidos não têm controle nem jurisdição. Fim de citação. John Quincy Adams rematou a sua argumentação com uma referência subtil à questão do General Armstrong, sobre o qual diz, e cito, até à data, sem sucesso, o ministro dos Estados Unidos no Rio de Janeiro há muito tem pedido satisfações e indemnização para os cidadãos norte-americanos por perdas e danos sofridas em jurisdição territorial do governo português. Fim de citação. Em virtude dos desafios colocados pelo curso atlântico à política de neutralidade adotada, quer por Portugal, quer pelos Estados Unidos, o fantasma do brigue General Armstrong reergueu-se dos mares açorianos como um trunfo do Departamento de Estado na contenda diplomática entre os dois países que, apesar das mudanças políticas que, entretanto, ocorreram em Portugal, se haveria de arrastar até 1852, quando uma comissão de arbitragem internacional presidida por Luís Napoleão colocaria um ponto final nesta questão. Mas isso já seria matéria para outra comunicação e eu não quero abusar da vossa paciência, que naturalmente agradeço. Muito obrigado.
Senhoras e meus senhores, os comunicantes estão de certeza abertos, talvez tenham perguntas, pedidos antecedentes, mas que façam de novo se manifestarem.
Professor Joshua Smith has additional information for you.
What one of the British complaints about this battle, and the British whine a little bit, is that the Americans apparently had run out of ammunition at one point and are firing out of their cannons, scrap metal, old belt buckles, anything, and it creates very fearsome maneuver. So apparently there was a problem with bullets, so your question is very good. Yes, that's right.
Broken knives, yes. Or was one of the charges that could break knives, any kind of metal sharp object.
Before they arrived, most of some body armor and body armor rehearsal to tell they are coming. How did the people know that they were coming?
The General Armstrong simply came into port to get water. He was only given 24 hours to be here. Dabney comes on board and says, "We haven't seen a British warship in weeks." And then 2 hours later, one British warship comes in, and then two other just by luck. Dabney now says to Captain Reed, "Don't worry, you're in neutral waters. It won't be a problem." The State Department doesn't always get it right.
Where
they arrived, how did they know that they were coming?
Because there was no telegraph.
Yeah, nobody knew anything until they saw the enemy coming.
Ah.
So there was no warning.
Hence the 24-hour rule was, we really don't want to fight here. We know this is between you and the American, you and the British. 24-hour, that's all you get, and get out.
They didn't. So this was all after the fact, and I think it's a fairy tale. I don't think that Andrew Jackson had no idea who was coming. And there's that battle too. Has a lot of mythology about it that isn't true. Andrew Jackson didn't need a lot of troops. It was actually about 120 artillerymen who did all the killing at that battle and all the Kentucky militia.
Another question. With your permission, I'll be just trying to give some information. Eu não estou seguro do que vou dizer, mas há pelo menos dois documentos de correspondência trocada entre o Elias Jair, que era um governador militar do Felipe, e o capitão-general em Angra, que, quando consultado, informou o Elias J. Ribeiro aqui na horta de que os Estados Unidos tinham declarado guerra à Inglaterra, é o início da guerra de 1812, o Elias J. Ribeiro mandou imediatamente uma carta que não está nessa documentação. Eu tenho-a, vou trabalhar isso um dia destes. É uma carta em que o Elias J. Ribeiro pergunta. Isto é uma antecipação extraordinária. Ele parecia que estava a prever o que ia acontecer dois anos depois. Então, o Elias Jair Ribeiro pergunta ao capitão-geral, no caso do Porto da Horta, que é neutro, se acontecer uma violação da neutralidade, quais os procedimentos que ele deveria adotar e dá as várias hipóteses. A entrada do navio americano e a chegada posterior do navio inglês, a entrada de um navio inglês, nosso aliado, e a posterior chegada de um navio americano, ele coloca essas hipóteses todas. Por outro lado, e aqui eu tenho uma grande dúvida, no topo da Espalamaca, no sítio onde hoje se chama o facho, eu não sei se nesta altura já existia, mas os Dabney, pelo menos no tempo do Charles William Dabney, eles tinham vigias nos montes para dar indicação de quando se aproximassem navios mercantes. Ora, eu não sei se nesta circunstância em que o governador militar coloca a possibilidade de ver as águas sul-africanas violadas, não sei se ele não teria tomado precauções também a esse nível e se a chegada dos navios britânicos não foi realmente previamente anunciada. Não sei. Estou apenas a colocar uma hipótese.
O navio ficou aqui afundado.
Os heróis.
Sim. Quer dizer,
algo de facho lá nas
Américas,
liga lá
para dentro. A sua pergunta faz muito sentido. Entretanto, nesse período, depois da estadia do capitão Comandante Armstrong aqui da Horta, é possível que tenha havido movimento de navios entre a Horta e os Estados Unidos que levassem a notícia antes do Armstrong chegar, antes do Reed chegar aos Estados Unidos. É possível.
Acho que eu sou assim, muito melhor que isto.
Mais perguntas? Dr. Andrew Motto,
any questions, sir?
Official casualty number of casualties. There's any official of number of casualties between the two sides. They have all these years gone by. There's a number that we can go out more on the American side or on the English side. The casualties.
Casualties. Americans 9,
almost 200 British. 7 wounded Americans, 2 American dead, 120 British dead, according to the Americans, and another 150 British wounded.
Mais perguntas que quero fazer? I have a question, sir.
Yes, please.
At the time of the battle, there was a man here in Orta whose name is James John. Let me see the name. Thomas Parkin. Thomas Parkin is the British Vice Consul in Fayal. Did you ever come across with this name? Because he interfered in the conversations between John Pastorde and Lloyd. Do you have any information about the role it played in the conversations between both authorities?
I wonder if he was the author of the British letter.
Yes.
Because he writes very actually good things about the Americans, that they fought like lions, and the British, he regretted all the casualties. And that letter was not supposed to get out because the Royal Navy didn't want it.
Thomas Parkin is a very controversial personality because he is involved in many troubles here in the island. For instance, he is involved in the kidnap of the nuns of the nuns. Não havendo mais perguntas. Vamos então terminar esta. Vamos ter agora um pequeno intervalo, porque estamos atrasados. O intervalo seria às 16h30, portanto, quase meia hora. Regressaríamos às 16h45, mas eu propunha que regressássemos às 16h10. Um cafezinho?
17h10.
Doutora Márcia, estava a dizer aí alguma coisa?
Não, 17h10,
estava
a dizer
16h. 17h10. 60 e 10 está bem?
Está bom, está.
Pronto. 60 e 10, muito obrigado.
Yes.